pretty much just a soundtrack set to moving images. Jamie?
Yeah?
Let's go watch Less Than Zero.
Welcome to another episode of Good Times, Great Movies. This is a podcast here that you're listening to. I hope you're aware of that.
I like to think people have no idea what they're listening to.
They just stumbled upon and they're like, what's this in my earbuds? Well, here we are. I am one half of this podcast. I am Jamie Lorello. On the other side of the tracks, I suppose, is DP McCambridge. Mm-hmm.
I don't know. The other side of the tracks?
Yeah, like, you know. The other side of the movie.
There is no other side of the tracks in this movie. They're all on the same side of the tracks, right?
A very elite side of the tracks.
Very elite.
There's no trains anywhere near them, I don't think.
Maybe those slick Amtrak trains.
That are bebopping, zipping around. This is a movie for the wealthy, I guess.
And for the wealthy alone. Any sense to
you? Right. If you don't have either a tennis court or a swimming pool or...
If you're not the Beverly Hillbillies, don't watch this movie.
Right. Just a heads up. That's our public announcement.
Do you remember on the Beverly Hillbillies when their doorbell would ring and they'd all just stand there and look around like, where's this music coming from?
No, I don't.
And then they would go to the door and they'd be like, every time we hear that song, somebody shows up at the front door. That was such a great show.
It was a good one. And I don't actually think anybody ever used a doorbell in this movie. Robert Downey Jr. just sort of snuck up on people.
No, he climbed up the wall of his home. And broken with a credit card.
That's right.
Savvy no, there was guy. No doorbell ringing None. In this. And if anybody rang the doorbell, you wouldn't be able to hear it over LL Cool J
no.
and whatever other mm-hmm. music is playing.
And all the mm-hmm. great, yeah, and the groovy soundtrack. Yeah.
Right.
Do you have any housekeeping before we get into this?
You know, I think it is important at least to acknowledge, because of our last episode, mm-hmm. I think it's important to acknowledge that our new president is Donald Trump. And I could not think of anything more ridiculous than that.
Than that statement alone?
It's insane.
I know.
Jamie, you and I have talked on occasion mm-hmm. about how long we should do this podcast. I think once you said we should do it until we cover every movie made in the
80s. Yeah, it's a good goal.
I think at our pace that would take about 172 years, so we're probably not going to do that.
Sure.
But I think it's important for us to at least do this for another 4 years.
I think America needs us. Yeah.
Our listeners.
I do think.
I know it's only like an hour and 20 minutes every 2 weeks.
Yeah, but it's helping you.
For that time, mm-hmm. if you can forget about.
The leader of our country.
I don't know what's going to be happening 2 years from now, but if you can forget about that for an hour and a half.
Yeah.
I think this is a service we provide.
Yeah, I'm speechless, and this isn't a podcast about politics, or I'd get a little more wordy about it. But mm-hmm.
you get wordy about your speechlessness.
All right then.
Well, yeah, I think that came as a huge surprise to. Everyone? I would say including
him. Yeah, I think he was like, I didn't really think America was going to buy this, but all right, I guess I'm here now. He's such an orange man. Just so orange. How do you trust a person with that kind of coloring?
Think that's going to change? Like the orange face and the white
no,
eyes?
No, I think he'll enhance it even more. I would hope it would change, but what's it going to change to? Although presidents do tend to get grayer. Like, that's the thing.
And he is so old to begin with. He's 70. He's our oldest president we've ever elected.
Is this true?
I don't know if you know. Yeah. Our oldest before him was Reagan at 69. Trump is 70. He's going to be, he's going to look like the Crypt Keeper when he's done.
Oh,
all right, so we could go on and on about this, but
I can't go down that path. I didn't do enough.
So let's talk about a time when Trump wasn't our president and was just, I don't know, the most insane billionaire ever. The 80s.
Yeah, this time period inspired by it. Yeah, let's get into it. Let's just jump.
Right.
Let's just get into it. Okay, let's put our politics aside for now because we're not here to bring that up.
I don't assume to know the political positions of our audience. So I'm going to stop with the sentence right there because I don't know.
Okay, you don't. I don't know.
No, and if you didn't vote, you should be ashamed. Okay, let's move on.
That's all. Okay,
if you're half the country and didn't vote. I'm so angry with you right now. All right. So anyway, our movie is Less Than Zero from 1987.
87.
I did not even write down who directed this. Did you?
Oh, no.
I know it was my job to really walk through and take good notes.
Yeah, and you usually keep note on that.
I wrote it was directed and written by John Carpenter. That's not
correct. No, that is not correct. That's our other movie that we recently did. Not particularly this one.
But it doesn't matter who directed it. It's based on the Bret Easton Ellis novel. Have you read any
American
Ellis ever?
Psycho?
You did read it?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
I did too.
Okay. And great. We share that in common.
Well, I don't know. And then like the movie came out. Everybody really loves the movie.
Well, sometimes I have that tie with a book where, and I read American Psycho long, I feel like it was long ago, but it was long enough ago to me. And I didn't, American Psycho had, the movie had, what's his name in it?
Christian Bale.
Thank you. I was going to call him Evan. I don't know
Evan
why.
Evan Bale? He looks like an Evan.
Right?
That's kind of a trendy name.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Uh-huh. I did not read this.
No, I didn't
read
this one.
But in doing research, I found out that it is extremely loosely based on the novel. In the novel, Clay is the main character, but he comes home from college, and he just does a ton of drugs and has casual sex with men and women and meets a lot of his friends. He does meet Julian. Like, Julian is a drug-addicted prostitute, but isn't the main character in the book.
And so it's not – because really it's about the three friends.
Right. No, it's about Clay just basically living
Blair's
it up.
Blair's not there.
Blair's there, but doesn't, you know –
Not the character.
I don't know. I didn't read it, but from what I read, it's mainly Clay's story about him acting like a crazy person when he's home from break. And then at the end, he just goes back to school. So it is
kind of loose because it's true. Clay is not as crazy.
It's a true story. All right. But we should get into this. We're like 15 minutes in. We haven't.
I know.
All right,
I know.
So
we're getting into Christian Bale, right? Is that what we're getting into?
This is the Christian Bale cast. Let's talk about his first movie, White Fang.
It was a Disney movie, I'm pretty sure. No, okay.
I'd like to hope that I edited out everything before this and everybody's like, Christian Bale wasn't in White Fang? What are they talking about? All right. This movie's about three friends.
Yeah.
And the three friends are Clay, played by Andrew McCarthy. Yay! Favorite of the podcast, Andrew McCarthy. Jamie Gertz plays his high school girlfriend, I guess, Blair.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Which at first you just think that they're three friends. I mean, obviously because there's a girl involved, you assume she's probably connected romantically to one. Mm-hmm. But really you don't, when we're introduced to them, you just see them as three good friends.
Exactly. Yeah. And the third one, the third part of this trio is Julian, played by Robert Downey Jr. Mm-hmm. And they're graduating high school.
Did you think it was weird that they had champagne at their high school graduation?
I did. Yeah. And a lot of champagne. Everybody, the one guy walked by Robert Downey Jr. and had enough champagne to hand him two bottles while he still had like another two.
And then you wonder why these kids end up having kind of different problems with drugs and that kind of thing.
Right.
And the parents too. So we're at their graduation and their parents are very nonchalant about everything, right? Like, I think even Robert Downey Jr.'s or Julianne's dad was like, yeah, we didn't think you'd get this far. And it wasn't college they were graduating from, right? It's high school.
It was high school. Yeah, they didn't think he'd graduate high school.
Right.
But also at the beginning, he's giving a speech. So he's the valedictorian?
Oh.
I'm pretty sure. Who else gives a speech, right?
Yeah, no. You are right.
So I think he's the valedictorian. Basically, this movie tells you that if you come from a broken home, your life is ruined.
Yeah. Well, even no matter how much money you come from.
No matter how much money. Yeah. Exactly. Rich people have problems, too.
Yeah. Yeah. They just can afford a lot of...
pools?
And drugs. Pools and drugs.
Well, they can afford drugs. Their children cannot, though. So get involved. I mean, unless you're a model. Do you think that Aaron Spelling watched this movie and was like, 30-year-olds graduating high school? I have a great idea for a TV show. Everyone in Beverly Hills must just look old. Because James Spader was in high school with these people. He looks like he's 40.
Yeah, he does. He does, with the slick back hair, and even the way he handles himself. Like, what?
The amount of gel and hairspray. I don't know. I want to know what the gel hairspray budget was on this movie.
You're curious to know. Yes.
Now, we didn't see James Spader at graduation, right?
No, that's why it's weird. He does come up and he claims that he's like an old friend, or Julian even says a couple times, we're old friends. But Clay says a bunch of times, like, we're not really friends.
They're graduating. Robert Downey Jr. is a record producer?
He's going to become a record producer, right?
I thought he said he was, because his record label, Tone Deaf Records. And that's it. That's what he's going to do. He is going to be a record producer.
Right. But funded by his dad. He even openly says, right? Yeah.
Right. Funded by his dad. Mm-hmm. And then that's it. That's like the cold open to this movie. Like, oh, these kids graduated high school. And now I guess their lives as adults, quote unquote, are going
to
begin.
They say they have the summer together before they're going to go on to life because I want to always call him Chase. Actually, in my notes a bunch of times, I wrote down Chase. Again,
that's a better name.
Right? Especially for his character. We don't just call him Chase for the rest of the movie?
Sure.
I think that'll confuse the audience. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's fine. I don't care. It doesn't matter.
Because in my notes, I was like, what's his damn name? Chase. So he is going off to college, and he's going to the East Coast to go to college.
So Clay's at school. Mm-hmm. He gets a phone call, and it's from Jamie Gertz, and she's out of her mind. Like, she's... I guess she's just crazy coked up or something. I don't know. And she's like, are you coming home for Christmas? I just want to see you.
Right.
And he is. He says that he's coming home for Christmas.
Yeah, that's the plan.
And then we get black and white flashbacks.
Yeah, that was weird. I was like, wait, is there something wrong with... And it is. It's a flashback, right?
Something was wrong
with the TV.
With my television.
Yep. Yeah.
Are we stupid? Because there were other times where we watched movies. And remember the one time you were like, I thought the sound on my TV wasn't working. Okay. I was like, I thought the same thing. Are we that dumb? Once you see the first black and white flashback, you know what's happening.
Right.
But I really thought, I was like, is this an artistic choice?
I think.
Have her scenes in black and white?
I know, right? Well, I guess because it happened in the past, they wanted to make sure that you knew that it was.
I would have preferred a Wayne's World doodly doo doodly doo sort of dreams. That would have been great.
That would have been awesome.
But so we find out that he and Jamie Gertz were, I'm sorry, Blair and Clay. Oh, they're not.
I did Jamie.
Stupid.
I know.
Blair, Clay, and Julian. Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
They're rich
Were
kids.
These real names in the 80s?
They're
well, Blair
kids.
Was on, what's it called?
Facts of Life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they were boyfriend and girlfriend, I guess, in high school, or at least the summer
They were
afterwards.
More romantic. Yeah, they were more romantically involved. Right. And they had affections for each other. They were attracted to each other, what have you.
Right.
He wanted her to move with him to the East Coast.
To go to college with him.
And she was afraid to leave. She admits that in the black and white. We get that kind of flashback that she was afraid to go with him. So right. That's
why she stayed. It's one of the many times in this movie when the characters literally say their emotions.
Yeah, like, so literally that we know.
Spell it out for the audience mm-hmm. so we understand what's happening.
So we have a full perspective, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we also
She's a model. She's a model too, because she's like, I'm just starting to get all the good jobs and everything. And I don't want to say if you're a model, just push off college, but that modeling thing's not going to last forever. I feel like you should take advantage of that when you can.
Yeah. And but she's a weird, like, what? Remember the photo shoot she's doing where she has the apple a soap on model. Her neck?
No, soap? It's a soap. It's a bar of soap. Soap
on her neck, though. Like, are they even taking a picture of her face? Or are they just using her?
So you think she's like a neck model, like a hand model?
Yeah, like a body part model. Like, I don't even. Right. I mean, she's beautiful. She's Jamie Gertz, but still. Anyway, the other thing in the flashback we see is that he must have come home at a certain point.
Oh, he came home for Thanksgiving.
Ah,
because he says happy Thanksgiving. That's or right. Whatever.
He throws the flowers. Well, she's in bed with Julian.
Robert Downey Jr. Yes. Which then made me think, wait, is this his first year of college?
Yes.
So he was just home in Thanksgiving,
mm-hmm.
found them in bed together, and what, 2-3 weeks later, he's coming back?
Well, he's coming back because of her phone call, though.
He was coming back for Christmas anyway.
No, I don't know that for sure. I wasn't inside his head. That wasn't something he expressed. But he does mention, like, when she, like, his whole motivation for coming back was because of the message she left. He thought that she wanted to see him. So I assume that he would have come home anyway to see his lovely family.
His family is weird.
Weird, right? Totally weird.
Totally weird.
Wait, we'll get there, but how long does Christmas last in this movie? It's like a Hanukkah. It's like a 3-day, like, Christmas is every day for them. Right? Or did the days not, like, I couldn't keep track of what.
No, but he's in college. I mean, he probably comes home middle of December, and he probably doesn't have to go back till early January, you know?
Like, yeah, yeah.
You know, that Christmas break in college, or that holiday break, that's long. That's like a month long.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Okay.
So, I mean, they literally do it one day, say that it is Christmas.
But I feel like they say that a lot of times. But I guess you're right. I guess they must be referring to Christmas as Christmas break. Because I feel like a lot of times they're like, oh, it's Christmas. So, oh, that's right. I have to go home for Christmas. Right. But I guess they're referring to the whole time period as being
such
Christmas
a religious
time.
Movie.
I know.
Come on. Fine. We'll keep the Christ in Christmas, Julian.
Right? As long as we could keep the Coke up our nose, right?
That's right. Then he travels back to the West Coast, right. Mm-hmm. And we listen to the entire Bangles song.
The whole song.
And we said earlier, the music in this movie is really good. Like, this soundtrack is amazing.
It's pretty 80s, pretty groovy 80s.
It's pretty 80s, but it's an insanely diverse soundtrack too.
It's
not just one style of music.
Mm-mm.
So and we do, I think we hear the entire Bangles song. I think there might be another one or two times in this movie where we hear an entire song.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I agree.
So he goes home, and I do want to say this, he goes home and his parents aren't there. No parents are ever
They're rich. They're out making money or spending money, I guess.
So he goes into his room. He listens to another message from Blair.
Do you note how many jelly beans he eats before the big giant bowl of jelly beans he dips into when he goes home?
No, I was not counting. Did you count?
I didn't count them. No, it wasn't like a jelly bean jar.
He has a weird... There's one scene later where he's talking to Blair, and the whole time they're talking, he's eating a lemon. He's eating a lemon in that club. Yes. He's just nibbling on it. Like, every time they cut to him, he's nibbling on this lemon. I'm like, this is disgusting.
Like, it's out of a drink or something. Right. Yeah, you're right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, he goes in, there's a big jar of jelly beans, Christmas jelly beans, and he just digs into them, like... Because that's what rich people have in their home for Christmas.
So his addiction is food? Is that what we're meant to believe?
Sugar. He's got a sugar.
Sugar and lemons. Sweet and sour is his thing. But when he does sit down on his bed to read through mail or whatever he's doing. Did you notice in the background there's a magazine called Teen Machine, which makes me wonder, is he getting this magazine? And it has Kirk Cameron on the cover of it.
Oh, no, I didn't see that. That would have been awesome.
It's really
catch.
Great because it's in his room. I'm like, why is he getting a magazine that like a 13-year-old girl would be into?
Well, I do like that his room supposedly looks, well, I think it looks exactly like as if he had left it yesterday. It's kind of a mess.
It's a mess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It looks like either somebody was in there messing around, or they were just like, this is how Chase left his room. This is how we're
Well, he was there 3 weeks ago for Thanksgiving.
I guess, they're like,
he's coming home again soon. We're not going to mess up his, throw his mail on his bed. Just let his answering machine get all his messages for him.
He'll be fine. But she does leave him a message, though, about coming to a party.
A party. This whole movie is parties. And every party looks like the party that we saw 10 minutes before.
Yeah,
I could not differentiate one from another. It's all neon lit, insane colors, loud music.
Well, this is the TV party, though. That's the only distinctive thing, yeah. Why? They're everywhere.
Why? Why are there so... This is... someone's house, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And
with all these TVs,
it was part of a, I don't know, like an art piece maybe, because the other thing they do in Palm Springs looks like it's art gallery related.
I think it's important to talk about the fact that upstairs in this room there's an Antarctic room.
Oh yeah,
which makes less sense.
Yes.
So
yes,
this entire house appears to be an art piece.
It's very bizarre, but it's, I guess that's how we party in.
But we do see that it's fun. Like, people are falling in the pool. James Spader comes up, and James Spader's wearing this giant coat. It's like he's wearing a zoot suit or something.
Yes,
he has
huge,
like, duster sport coat on. Mm-hmm, every guy in this movie is dressed like it's business casual day on a Friday at work. These 19-year-olds are wearing sport jackets everywhere. Yes.
Again, I guess it's the lifestyles of the rich. I don't know that they're famous in this movie, but they are definitely rich.
So
this is how they party. This is how they dress. This is their... I do like, too, when he shows up at the party, he's just sort of... One girl, as soon as he gets there, is making out with him, kind of gives him, like, a very, you know, sensual kiss. He grabs the ass of another girl. When James Spader does come up to me, puts a little bit of drugs in his pocket. I think he puts like
a little vial of coke or whatever. Yeah.
So these are the parties to go to if you're looking for a good time. These are
awesome parties, and there are parts in this movie where I feel like there was no script or direction given. Like, he talks to those girls who are sitting on TVs, and they just talk about nonsense, like nothing that makes any sense. And then at the end, he's like, hey, you do know that there's TVs between your legs, right? No reaction from them, and he walks away.
And he's just moving on.
There's a part later where he's talking to Julian on the rock in the ocean. And as he's walking away, Julian's like, hey, watch out for the sharks. And he's like, oh, yeah. What about you? Oh, they're fine with me. Oh, do you need anything? No. Oh, okay. All right, I'll see you. All right, bye. I'm like, what? Is this written? No.
That's the weird thing about... So we're meant to think that these are tight. They're a tight trio that were besties. And now, obviously, there's some friction that was caused by... I'll call him by Clay finding out that Julian and Blair had a thing.
Did you say I'll call him by his real name and you called him by his character's name?
Sorry.
No. I know what you meant, but that just, like, I was waiting for you to say Andrew McCarthy and you were like, Clay.
Because I want to call him Chase.
Okay.
When he sees her for the first time, they obviously have like a real good chemistry together, right? I couldn't tell when we're first introduced to Jamie Gertz in this party if she was either supposed to be really high or just really doing a bad job acting or what.
She talks like someone who has discovered the power of speech. Like, she's all over the place, but her line delivery is stilted and odd, and she's excited but not. And it's a bad job of playing high, I guess.
Later, she does better at when she's got to do be high. But this first part, I was like, I don't know if she's going to pull this off.
Yeah.
Because it's weird. And so their interaction initially is weird. But one thing she does sort of get across to him is that she wants his help with Julian.
But
right?
Is this when he's trying to make out with her? And she's like, no, but our friend... No, but Julian needs our... She's trying to tell you something. And last time you saw her, she was sleeping with this guy. Like, maybe...
Yeah.
Maybe this isn't what she wants.
Yeah, maybe you should back it up.
Yeah, well, she literally does, like, walk away from him while she's talking. Because he's oddly aggressive. Weird. Yeah.
And then he then does see Julian. And again, their interaction, it's not... Meaning, it's very awkward and weird when they first see each other again at the party. It's just kind of like, hey.
Yep.
Like you said, it's like the when they're at the beach and they talk about the sharks.
Right.
It's just like, hi.
Yeah, it's like when actors sometimes talk about roles and they're like, oh, and we did all these auditions and we hung out every day, so we got comfortable with each other. This almost seemed like the first day of shooting. They all showed up at the set and the director was like, hey, Andrew McCarthy, this is Robert Downey Jr. You guys have never met. Ready and action, go.
So their initial interactions together are weird. And then
I like how Julian's wearing eyeliner. I thought that was great.
Yeah, and later on he's got it on too, and it smudges. Like, I guess because he's a record producer, so he's hip like.
But he's not. We find out his record producing days lasted what, like a week or something like that.
Oh,
if it even got off the ground. And his whole thing is he's trying to start a club.
Mm-hmm.
But is he really, or is this just nonsense that he tells people to try and get the money that he owes James Spader?
No, because he does take his uncle to a place later that really is. I think, again, he's
very
just
much like
a...
Xanadu.
Yeah, it is. You wanted Olivia Newton-John to just roller skate in and be like, don't worry, no coke needed.
I would have loved to see a coked up Robert Downey Jr. skating all around this movie. I would have loved it. Because I do have to say something before we get too far. We talked about how good the music is. Mm-hmm. Robert Downey Jr. is killing it. Start to finish, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe you don't. Oh, yeah. But I think he is the most capable in this movie. James Spader's pretty good.
Now, I kind of imagine, too, that especially it being the wealthy, this was kind of a lot of their lifestyle of this kind of Rat Pack 80s group. You know what I mean?
I'm sure.
All these parties and the way they partied in the Palm Springs and even the weird artsy TV. I'm sure these were the kind of things that they went to.
It did feel like something that would have been better presented in novel form. Like, I'll bet in the book it really got into this lifestyle, these people, what was happening.
Right.
I don't know that this translated that well to the screen, because it seemed like a parody of an 80s movie. Like, it's everything was so over the top. The outfits were bonkers. Crazy. And it seemed more like a parody than a movie trying to be genuine. But maybe it's just looking at it.
Except for the performances. Right. Yeah. And then I think, too, I wasn't going to speak to this now, but I will. I get it, because we were supposed to. I feel like there was a relatable piece missing because they were so wealthy.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like if at least one of them were middle class, I would have felt a little more like, because you got it, like, it was relatable to me in the sense that, like, okay, after high school, you've got a bond of friends, and one of them goes away and trying to reconnect, and even the whole jealous lover and that whole piece, you kind of were like, oh, but it was the amount of, not even just the amount of drugs, but the amount of wealth
it's
and that
everything,
kind of thing that I was
because it is, everybody has high school friends, and you graduate, and you go your separate ways, but one of you is going to an Ivy League school, the other one becomes a professional model, and the other one is a record producer? That doesn't happen.
I know
happen.
We're kind of jumping all around, but so Blair and Julian move, they live in a loft together, right? That they easily can afford because
he's
a record producer and she's a model.
They live together?
Well, yeah, that's the... I thought that was the loft that they're in. And at the end, we see when they're in that loft, did you see the big black and white picture? It's a huge black and white, like, portrait in the background of the three of them.
That is the shittiest looking portrait, because I'm looking at it. I'm like, all right, I guess that's Robert Downey Jr. That's Jamie Gertz. And there's an old man next to them. It looks like garbage.
But it's them. And I thought that it was their loft that they got together, because she even says at one point, oh, yeah, Julian doesn't hang out at the loft anymore.
I just thought it was her place. And I thought that he just sort of spent time
there
at different places. I didn't think it was their place together. I don't know. Whatever. He sleeps on a park bench at one point.
And when he goes home, he tells his dad, I just need to know where I'm waking up tomorrow. So maybe it's more her place and not his. But
all right, let's get back into this movie, because I think we've done a good job of analyzing these characters in this movie. Now we can just fly through it.
We're good.
So after this party, everybody sort of falls into their roles. We find out what they're doing, what's happening, and they have odd, strange interactions. But they finally do leave in Clay's red Corvette, which plays a major role in this movie. Anytime somebody's driving, it's that car. Robert Downey Jr. is really wasted.
Oh, yeah. His feet are hanging out.
He's standing up. He's singing Christmas carols. He almost dies. He almost falls.
Yeah, he almost falls out of the car. Nearly gives Blair a heart attack. She's kind of... But then she kind of finds it endearing. Oh. He's, you know, the crazy guy.
But what's weird is, was he always the crazy guy? Or is this all strange for Clay? Like, was he the crazy guy in high school? Or is this all new? Is that why he's so weirded out by all of this?
No, I think he senses the drug use. I think that's because Clay doesn't really know if he
used drugs in high school and it was just like, oh, this has gotten out of control. Or who is this guy? I've never seen this kind of behavior before.
I'd like to think that they were a little crazy, because when they convince him to come, Clay, to like, come on, let's go out like old times. It is a feeling of like they used to be crazy together. I don't know that the drug use was as rampant and that kind of thing, but you do get the sense like when they were the three of them were together, it was the trifecta. Mm-hmm. They were fun. They were, you know.
So they go out.
The triple threat, if you will.
They were the triple threat. All right, so they go to different clubs. They go to a restaurant which has these gigantic booths, like these really high.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And they go to this other club. Like, they go to this club that looks like a Grand Central Station turned into a club.
Mm-hmm.
And they're dancing, and Blair sometimes seems really concerned with Julian, but other times, like, I guess maybe she went in the bathroom and did some bumps or something.
I was going to say, I think it depends how high she is. And then she comes back and she's like,
I look really good. Come dance with me. Like, what is going on here? Their behavior is insanely erratic.
It is very weird. That's why it was hard to follow. Because you're right. So at first, you get the feeling like Clay doesn't want to be involved with them. And then all of a sudden, they're all out together partying. And she's weird. Yeah, she's weird too at first, or throughout, I guess. I think that it's because you're supposed to get a sense of how there's just this connection between her and Chase, Clay.
Good old Chase.
You know, there's this magnetism between them. Mm,
okay.
You know, and there's, I don't know.
All right. I don't know. Like, maybe
Do you buy that? Are you for that?
Not at all.
No. Okay.
Maybe she just feels like he's bringing some normalcy back into her life. Like, maybe things have been really crazy for her, because she talks about how Julian disappears for days. Nobody knows where he is. He comes back and he's really sick. And I'm like, well.
Clay even kind of says to her, like, you're an addict like he is. And she's like, no, I can stop anytime. It's totally different for me, because when he comes into her modeling shoot, remember?
And we do find out that she's totally right. She could just stop whenever she
wants. Yeah, and she does. She's like, no. Meanwhile, our poor friend Julian has to give head to do his drugs. And it gets crazy. It gets crazy for Julian.
I don't know. He's just paying off a debt. All right, we'll get there. So
okay.
The next day, after this night of partying, Julian wakes up on a park bench with just some random little kid on a swing, which I'm like, where is this kid's parents?
Oh, yeah, this is weird.
Who would just put their little kid on a swing and be like, oh, there's just some man sleeping on the bench. We're going to be way over here.
Well, And he parked his car right at the park, right?
Yep.
Wait, back it up. Before he's at the park, we find out that he actually owes $50,000.
At first, I thought he was saying 15. Even when he went to his uncle, I was like, he's asking for 15. I'm like, that's a lot of money. And later on, I'm like, holy shit, it's 50?
50. Well, and that's what's funny, too, is I'm like, how did that drug debt get that out of control?
Right, exactly.
Because James Spader keeps saying, like, you know, I've been really good to you. I've really kind of helped you out. But he keeps giving him drugs, and he keeps letting this debt.
So was this like a long con by James Spader's character being like, listen, I know what great BJs this dude gives. He is going to be a prostitute because I'm going to run him up for 50 because you got to figure – nobody's going to let you go that long and run up that kind of, I'm going to call it a bill, a drug bill.
Okay. Okay. A tab.
Like that's a ton of money. Like when you get to 10 grand, that's when you confront the guy and you're like, listen, you got to work this off.
You would do it.
Right. Exactly. 10,000.
You're like, I got a limit.
That's a lot of money.
That is.
Don't let it get to 50. And I don't know how much drugs cost in the 80s.
Right. But that has to be a lot, like 6 months worth. That had to be from when he graduated high school till now. Right. He's been doing such an intense amount of drugs that I think it's because he.
And is he smoking because crack? He was the record because crack's pretty cheap, right? Or is he what's he smoking?
I thought he was smoking crack. He smokes something, and I want to say is crack. I don't know. What else do you smoke like that out of a pipe? Was he smoking heroin? Do you smoke heroin?
You can smoke heroin, but.
Well, he was smoking something shadily. That look like crack, heroin, or something.
I like it when Bill just like heats it up for him, and he's like, "Here, I'll
take it." Because he's got to do the deed. Because he's like, "All right, we're just gonna do this now." But that's at the end when you think he's gonna get clean. Right, okay, we're not there yet.
What I would do, and I would suggest to people, and this is ruining whether I recommend this movie or not. I would buy the soundtrack for this movie.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I would put on the soundtrack and just put the movie on mute. You don't need to hear anything that they're saying. You just need to see the crazy outfits and insane settings and listen to the music. That's worth it. Because you're right. The outfits are out of control. When he's wearing that shirt with what looks like a blood stain all over it. Yes.
I thought he was shot. When he first shows up with that, I was like, oh, Julian's injured bad. Because it looks like a big red blot. And then... he doesn't stop wearing it.
Nope.
He goes
and there's like feathers attached too. There's like two black feathers attached
and
to it.
And it changes. Like the red blotch was at first near his hip, then it's up near his chest. It's a very weird, not attractive shirt. And she at one point is wearing like a suit jacket as a dress, which I think was fashionable.
Yeah, she's like wearing her power suit.
Yeah.
He's naked on the bed when he's all sweaty and his crotch is covered by a pillow.
I do love when he's like coming down and he's just naked.
And then she walks out. She walks out in her power suit. And this is another weird line where I don't think any of this was written because she talks to him and then she's walking away and he's like, "Hey, you look really great in that outfit." And she looks down like, "You weren't supposed to say that," but she's like, "Thanks." End of scene.
Yeah. For these, this is what else I felt for throughout the whole thing was for these three friends that were supposedly really tight. Like later on, we find out that Julian and Clay know each other since they're like five, even before They don't really like even so like at the park, like you were saying before, when Julian's at the park and he's the kids are swinging and Clay goes there because again upon. Blair's urgency to like say you need to help Julian, he needs your help, he needs you, he tries to like have a heart to heart with him, but it's weird, he's just like, "How you doing? Yeah, not so good."
These
people
do not seem like they want to talk,
they don't
to
seem
another.
To care about each other. Yeah, they don't seem into each other at all, and I get it, there's friction because he's been with her and that kind of thing, but
so anyway, we have a lot to go over. So after he talks to him in the park and nothing is resolved, nothing's ever resolved. Like, these conversations go
nowhere. They keep it, and their conversations just end. They're weird. Like, there's a weird heart-to-heart where it's like, "I'm here because I care," but then he's like, "Oh, yeah? Your hair is greasy."
There's a scene in this movie later that I swear to God is out of place. I swear I was watching a cut of this movie.
The one where he's with the little girl?
No, the one where he's talking. No, the one where he's talking to his dad and his dad's playing tennis.
Oh,
and
yeah.
He had just sobered up, and I'm like, "You look like shit." Like, this scene should have been earlier in this movie. Because he just sobered up, then went to talk to his dad, and his face is all bloody, and his lips are all chapped. And I was like, you just sobered up, dude. And then the next scene, he looks great. I'm like, who put this movie in this order?
There is a time, it's like the last, like, I don't know, kind of quarter of this movie, where Robert Downey Jr. just has that white all around his lips. He's just like... He just looks nasty, and the white on his lips, and there's the mascara like running off his face. That you're like, what are you doing? Somebody just give the man a tissue to wipe his face off, or is it maybe it's not Chadwick?
And I feel like we have to come out. We have to say seriously, drug addiction is not funny, folks. But this movie paints it in the goofiest light possible. Because you're right, he looks like garbage, and he is when he goes up in the oh my god, we're getting so ahead. But I love it when they find him in the stairwell
He sobers up.
He's just running down the hallway, crashing into the walls, puking all over himself.
Yeah,
and Andrew McCarthy looks disgusted by all of
them. Yeah. Well, could you imagine though? That's that scene. I was like, oh yeah, that. Because that's when you see, again, we're fast-forwarding, but that's when you see, so this is what Blair's been dealing with.
Right, exactly.
And this is the role she's taken in their lives. And this is why Andrew McCarthy's like, whoa, we were three crazy friends, but we weren't this, you know?
Yes. And I mean, it's all James Spader's fault, I guess, is what we're meant to believe. Because James Spader's...
he's been pumping the drugs. Yeah, $50,000 worth of drugs.
Blair goes to see Blair at her job modeling soap with her neck.
So
and
again,
it's another weird interaction where he goes into her dressing room and she's doing coke and they talk about, I don't know, nothing. And he's like,
yeah,
oh, I'm
it's
gonna
a weird conversation.
I think I'm going to go back to school right after Christmas. And she's like, okay, it's just make sure you say bye after before you leave. And he's like, yeah. And he leaves and she's like, I miss you.
Yeah,
and
she's brushing her hair the whole time. She's brushing.
It's so she's just brushing her hair like Marsha Brady, just crazy brushing. And yeah, there are times in this movie where I swear the direction was just like, I don't know, look emotional.
Well, because they're supposed to be coked out, I guess. Like
when he walks out, he leans up against the door and just kind of stares away, just stares into space for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know what he's thinking. I assume he's waiting for the director to say cut. This is when Julian needs to get $50,000, and he goes to his uncle,
right.
in his blood-soaked shirt pattern.
Yeah, in that weird,
And he's in a car dealership, which first I was like, why is he in a car dealership clearly after hours?
But that's where
where his uncle works. I love how, and he's like, I'm opening this club, I need 50 grand, I'll take you there, it'll be great.
Right.
And I love how his uncle's like, you want a bump? And he goes, yep.
Yeah, the uncle is like...
the uncle's like, let's go to my office.
Yeah. Well, and it's funny because you find out that this uncle... Because at first I'm like, oh, this is just the crazy uncle that like sells cars and does drugs. But no, later on, or I think it's at this point when Julian's like, come on, I'm like a son to you. He's like, I already have my own two sons. This is the uncle that he goes to kind of help him start this. And this business is supposed to not only help him kind of recover his drug money, but this is the next thing to kind of get him out of his hole. So we're told earlier that he's in a big hole because the record company went under and his plans originally after high school didn't really pan out. And the dad cut him off for money. Little later we find out the dad cut him off because he's a drug addicted liar.
Right.
But the uncle is going to allegedly still support him and give him money for this club.
And this is also when we find out that Blair's home life doesn't seem that great either. This is the only scene in the movie where we see her home
life. When she goes home. This is so weird too, right? How weird
it's very weird that she talks to her dad through the door.
Yeah, he's just a voiceover. We never see him. Or do we see him at the graduation, I guess, in the beginning?
No, because at the beginning... she says, oh, my dad couldn't make it. I guess his flight was late or whatever.
So
she talks to her dad through a door. And she's like, oh, I brought you a present or whatever. And he's like, oh, I'll be out in a little bit. And she's like, I got to go. And he's like, can't you stay and whatever. This is an entire conversation. She's talking to a door.
To the door. Uh-huh.
And then some woman walks out. I guess it's her stepmom, I'm assuming. Right? Like, that's
not her
mom.
No, I think it's the flavor of the month. I think it's definitely not her mom.
She calls her by her first name, whatever that is.
Mm-hmm.
And then you hear her dad in the background, like, Susie, get your ass back in here or something.
That's
I'm like,
what's
wait
so
a
weird.
Second, what?
Yes, it's very strange. So she, yeah, apparently her family life is pretty shitty. Again, she lives in a mansion, mm-hmm. a beautiful home. Mm-hmm. And Christmas to her, that's what I mean. I feel like, so this, I thought this was Christmas that she goes home to celebrate and her dad's, I guess, shacking up with this girl.
I guess
girl.
She's just dropping off the presents. You know, just yeah. like, oh, Christmas
she's
is coming
Santa
up.
Claus,
I brought... Yeah, because she does say, like, I brought you a present, and I don't understand. I don't understand Mm-mm. anyone's motivation. I don't understand why. Nothing's explained.
Well, after this interaction with her dad, right. and not even barely interaction with her dad, and then the dad's
right.
woman coming out, you tend to think, she's really got it the worst off. At least Julian has a supportive uncle, and the dad did try to give him money,
right.
and mm-hmm. Clay's family is really weird, but apparently he's got, like, a nice...
Sure. The,
nice
the
enough
waspiest
fam-
family
weird,
ever.
Though.
Yeah.
They are so weird when they play piano, and they do, yeah, I don't get that, but... She really has, like, she's got this cold, quiet house, and
right.
the dad won't even leave the bedroom to come say Merry Christmas.
No, it's so weird.
So if anyone has to have a drug problem, you would think it would be Blair, right?
Yeah.
But
she, I mean, and she is doing drugs.
I mean, she does,
but she seems
but
to
not...
have a handle on it. I mean, I know, I'm serious. I'm not.
It's an important thing.
I'm just saying, her drug use seems to be...
Manageable.
I was even going to say social, but no, she's in her dressing room doing lines of coke or whatever. But
right.
she seems, again, we find out that she can easily handle it, and she's holding down a steady
she's
job
working,
as a model.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm
mm-hmm.
not, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't have much problem with her drug use. Anyway, so then they go to more parties. Like, this movie is just parties. And
yeah.
Julian and Rip, oh, we did not say that James Spader's character's name is Rip.
Is Rip.
So they kind of have a fight at this club where he's like,
Julian,
I think you owe me something. He's like, oh, I'm done with you. Clearly coked out of his mind.
Yeah, he's so high. Uh-huh. This one now, the LL Cool J song.
This is where they
happens.
Run down an orange
yeah.
hallway and go outside and listen to LL Cool J. Yes.
That's right. Okay. Okay.
And then this is also when they have their romantic scenes, or the first of their romantic scenes, because Clay and Blair then... make out on this, like, fire escape.
Oh, you're right.
And they
yes.
get the car.
Yes.
They park in the middle of the road.
In
the
middle of the busy road.
Not for the
uh-huh.
only time in
the motorcycles
movie.
Cruising by
a
them.
A motorcycle gang rides, just flanks them and rides by
mm-hmm.
as they make
mm-hmm.
out and laugh like idiots.
Mm-hmm.
It is so
mm-hmm.
stupid.
It's so goofy. It's but I think that this was... again, because earlier they sort of resisted each other. It's like this is their time to finally be like, yeah, we're together. We're going to do this and we don't care. Because before this, they were kind of tentative about
right.
whether
yes.
they should be making out. And
mm-hmm.
clearly there's chemistry, but they didn't want to go for it. Now they're...
Right. So they go, I guess they go back to her loft. This is where they have sex.
But it's so weird. Like, is she wearing a cape during sex? Like,
it's just,
the weirdest.
It's, they're having sex amongst strategically placed sheets and jackets to where we see no nudity.
It's a jacket.
We barely
mm-hmm.
see any skin.
No, yeah. I really thought she was wearing a cape. And then I was like, is her ass that big? Because of the way that they... They didn't try to make her look...
It was like a big leather jacket. She was wearing, like, this
yeah.
gigantic leather jacket. And didn't take it off. Although he seemed to not be wearing anything.
Yeah, anyway, this is when we know that they've consummated their relationship. They're back on track, just like it was six months ago when they were...
I can't believe this is all taking place over 6 months.
Well, and I can't believe that they had that, I guess so. Like, I want to say that the intensity of their relationship became more so because of the distance and because of Julian becoming in the middle. Because I would think that if they're... Because they seem to have, like I said, like this real intense chemistry
for each other. I think it's because of drugs.
Oh, there
you know,
you go.
I mean, we don't see Clay take any drugs. Like, he is the cleanest and soberest person in this movie. Yeah, he is. Does he even drink?
And the most responsible. Like,
do we even see him drink an alcoholic beverage?
Maybe he's sucking the liquor off that lemon.
Well, yeah, he eats lemons and jelly beans, but I don't know if we even see alcohol. Or weed.
No,
like,
you're right.
We don't even see people just casually smoking pot in this movie.
No, it's either you're doing coke
Coke or nothing. That's it. Yeah. It's coke or crack, I guess.
Yeah.
Wow. Anyway, the next morning, Julian climbs up the side of his house and breaks in to his father's gym.
Oh, yeah.
His dad has like, he has like 30 barbells in a row that all appear to be the same weight, which doesn't make any sense at all. But he's stealing CDs. It really placed this, because 87, like, CDs were a pretty new thing.
Yeah,
then. They
were the new. Yeah.
So he seems to be stealing CDs to, I guess, you know, sell to get some money. I guess he's just, what do you think? Do you think he's just taking those CDs back to rip and he's like, here you go. How much am I $50,000?
How much can
debt?
I get for it? No, I guess he's taking them to, no, I would assume that he's going to.
Pawn shop.
We never see. Get the cash.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I would have loved to have seen him go to, and you started this with like the other side of the tracks. I would have loved to have seen a scene of him go to the bad part of town, like the shitty Hollywood that Nick Cage was such a great part of in Valley Girl. Like, you know, and like go to a pawn shop or something like that. But he never does. Like, he never leaves Beverly Hills.
Well, that's the thing. He doesn't really. Other than just asking people for money for this huge debt, there's really no effort he puts forth to clean up the debt.
No.
I mean, he does have to actually, work for. But, like, there's nothing. I think that.
Right. It's almost like he's like, prostitution. Like, I didn't try anything
else.
So I guess it's this.
Yeah. Like, if you're not trying to get another job, you're not trying to. Like, even at the end, like, Clay's thing is like, well, we'll all leave together. You just have to leave LA and that'll help. Like, that's not even in his head.
Well, I mean, unlike Jamie Gertz, who's handling her drug addiction quite well, I really, like, it has consumed him. Anytime we see him, he's just casually napping in public or, like, just
drinking booze or something. Yeah, and he does, I think that's before he goes to break into his house. He's, like, he's on, like, a drinking bender because he's been cut off from his drugs, right? So he, whatever it is, he needs to get fucked up all the time, basically.
So he's not thinking clearly where he can get a job at like Kmart or something like that.
You're not thinking responsibly.
His dad throws him out. I love how somebody who I guess is his little brother tries to fight him.
I think it's his brother,
Who doesn't look, you couldn't find an actor that kind of looked like Robert Downey Jr.
It's not that hard.
Yeah, this is some like sort of chubby kid. It doesn't look like him at all.
No. I don't know who this
It's very strange. But in the meantime, a guy with a notch cut into his eyebrow comes up to Blair's apartment looking for Julian. And this is, again, weird interaction in this movie when he wakes them up in the morning.
Well, so they're having their sort of like pillow talk time. Because they're planning, she wants children, like, maids to watch her children.
Yeah, come back to college with me. Yeah. She's like, no, but how about we get married? He's like, oh, that sounds great. I guess it's a joke. Yeah. None of this movie's played for laughs, but.
No, I know. It's not supposed to be funny, but some of it does make you kind of, but yeah, then you're right. So while they're having this moment, this crazy dealer guy.
The crazy dealer, because he comes up and he's like, I'm looking for Julian. Well, he's not here. I will tell him I stopped by. My name is Bill. You're Blair. I know you. But I don't know you. Okay, bye. What?
So crazy. So bizarre.
And he looks insane. Like, I was ready for this guy to become some, like, insane killer. Yeah. Like, he looks like a hitman. That's what he looks like. Mm-hmm. He's got the crazy goatee and just like the, like I said, there's like a notch shaved out of his eyebrow. It's like a vanilla ice thing.
Vanilla ice? Yeah.
And I expected this guy to just become bonkers crazy and just go nuts at some point, but he doesn't.
He's just kind of like the bodyguard of like,
Rip
drug dealers or the, Rip. Yeah, Rip.
Mm-hmm. Bill. The guy who has the most normal name in this movie is the guy with his eyebrow shaved. I love how his name is Bill. You couldn't think of another crazy name to give this
like
guy?
Tougher name. Hey. Yeah, even call him like I don't know what's tougher than Bill, but Louis is even tougher than Bill, isn't it?
Louis? It's more.
Is it?
It's more unusual, I guess. Louis is a tough name. All right.
Louis sounds more threatening than just Bill.
Right.
You better talk to Bill. You got to talk to Louis.
Louis does seem like he might break your wrist or your knuckles.
I think there's a tougher name than that. I can't think
of.
Nope, we can't think of any. Bill is not it.
Right. Okay. All right. Okay. Let's. So after this guy shows up, they become concerned and they go on the great Julian hunt, which.
Yes.
I don't know. They go to one place. They're like, maybe he's at the beach. Yeah, of course he is. That's where he is.
And yeah. Zuma. He's over in Zuma. Mm-hmm.
They find him on a rock in the ocean. Mm-hmm. And this is where they have, a bizarre interaction, which accomplishes nothing. And Julian's like, hey, I'm going to start a club. And Andrew McCarthy goes, hey, that sounds great. Yeah, I'm making a comeback. Oh, that sounds fantastic. So you're good, right? Uh-huh. I'm great. Okay.
And that's what I mean. Like, do you really care about each other as friends?
Not at all.
I don't feel like you do.
In the end of this movie, they say, we're going to take you to a hospital. No, don't take me to a hospital. The end of the conversation. That is it. If your drug addicted friend suddenly, for some reason, can barely walk or stand, you take him to a hospital. Like, what is he going to do?
Coming out of the bathroom, he has issues walking. Right. Yeah. You don't drive through the Joshua
Tree. No.
You just don't.
They say, I don't know. Let's take a nice 9-hour drive through the desert. Never stopping for gas. We'll be fine. Oh, it's all good. Anyway, so.
Got to get away from Bill, I guess.
Well, this is really fun because now it's Christmas and suddenly we are in a different movie. When his family is standing around this table and this dude is.
The golden table where everything is golden.
This guy. Is giving a speech, and I thought, this is not the same movie. Something happened. I'm watching something now that I'm not supposed to see. Because we pan around the table, it is just littered with characters, blonde hair, blue-eyed characters that I have never seen before.
No, you didn't even get introduced to them at the graduation. I guess you met his mom at the graduation.
His mom was there in a long shot where we really barely see her.
But not the sister. Like, apparently he's got two little sisters.
I don't know. There seem to be a ton of people.
Who's the guy playing the piano?
I thought that was his dad.
That's not his dad. He looked young, though.
I don't know. But it's Christmas at Clay's residence.
Christmas at Clay's family's house.
And... this whole part of the movie is just so stupid. And what does anything happen here? Like, Blair is there as his guest having Christmas dinner.
Yeah. They go off while the dad or whoever this dude is playing. It's very weird because he's playing kind of Christmas. It's not even Christmas carol. He's just playing piano for the people at the party. And the women at the party, there's two of them. I guess one of them is his mom. I don't know who. They're like sipping drinks like, oh, this is painful for us. Meanwhile, in some weird like outside hallway.
It's like between two trellises. Vines should be growing up this stuff. But you're right in that it comes out of the house like it's a hallway.
Yeah.
But it's outside.
But then later they come out of the bath. So they go in this area.
The geography of this house is crazy.
It's weird because they're rich. So Clay and Blair go into this little side area and they basically have sex, but they have standing up sex and there's a lot of licking involved in their sex.
Oh, the tongues. There's like
so much
tongues touching that dissolves into a dude playing a piano. And I'm like, this is uncomfortable.
It's so weird. It's so weird. And butt grabbing and really like,
It cuts back and forth. Sorry. It cuts back and forth. Anytime we're inside, it's this awful classical piano playing. And when they're outside, it's David Lee Roth's Bump and Grind. Like, literally, the name of the song is Bump and Grind. And it's not that one song, like, dissolves into another. It is these hard cuts between these two pieces of music.
Yes. But and I guess, and then like I said, there's the women drinking, looking bored, that as party if looks like awful. The fun is really happening. Yeah, but then. So Jamie Gertz or Blair comes out of what I think is a whole different area, like the bathroom.
I don't know.
And she's sort of like, you know, like something just happened. And she's having a conversation with.
She's fixing her hair, which is insane throughout this movie. Her hair goes through these wonderful transformations. Like college graduation, it's nice and smooth and long and straight. Mm-hmm. And then when he sees her in the Antarctic, it is just the puffiest. Curliest, ball, and her lipstick is the most red nonsense I've ever seen.
It's like they did. They took her through all the transitions. Now at this party, it's a different, like, slick back kind of 50s like bouffant.
Yep.
Yeah.
At one point, I think Robert Downey Jr. has, like, a pompadour. Did you notice that he has, like, a big, huge pompadour and then, like, a big curl that comes down?
Like, whoops. Uh-huh.
Yeah, and you're right. She comes out of a different part of the house, and she and his mom have a conversation, but it doesn't matter.
But she's distracted. No, it's a weird conversation, and she's distracted because she's clearly... He then, Clay also comes out from the same area, sort of kind of adjusting his pants and everything. Like, so... we know what's just
and
happened.
And they look at each other.
Merry Christmas,
they look at each other the whole time like, can you believe we just did that? I can't believe we just did that. That was so
awesome.
I know.
We just totally did it. We're going to do it again.
And we're totally tricking everyone at this party. We came in different doors from outside. They have no idea what happened.
Meanwhile,
gross lips disgusto boy shows up.
Crusty lips. Wait, back it up to when Julian, before the party or maybe interluded between the Christmas party, Julian goes to his uncle to show him the new spot for the club, he's like tap dancing over the, like, this is where the club's going to be, and the uncle's like, I'm not giving you the cash, your dad told me, because of the interaction, I guess, when you broke into the house and tried to steal CDs, I'm not allowed to give you the
and
cash.
And this is when I did figure out that club that he's buying is the club that they were at for that party, where there was the big stairwell with all the people hanging out. So that's the place that
he was looking at. Mm-hmm. Okay. But it's not going to happen because the uncle's not going to fund it.
Right.
So now Julian is basically taken. Isn't he taken to the motel? Is this when he's like Bill takes him to kind of do the dirty work?
Bill takes him. Well, he shows up at Rip's. And he's like, I don't know what to do. I'll get your money. Don't worry. Da da da. And Rip's really nice about it. And he's like, hey, it's not a big deal. You're just gonna come to work for me for a while. It's great.
You're just gonna have to do some
and
work.
And I love how Julian's like,
I can make deals.
A salesman. I can make deals. First of all, you did not let drug addicts sell drugs because they'll just do the drugs. Like, you don't do that.
Right. And not a drug addict that owes you $50,000 in drugs. Right.
Here, make sure all of this gets to its destination. That's not what you do with drug addicts.
I trust you. Yeah.
So he takes Bill, and it's implied that Julian is now a prostitute, right? Like, we don't see anything at this point. Bill's just like, hey, I'm going to take you to this party. And Julian's like... it's going to be great. There's just these really cool people there. It'll be awesome. Or not Julian, sorry. What's his name? Rip.
No, yeah. Rip. Yeah. He's like, you're just going to talk to some cool people, and it's going to be fun, and it's going to be fun. Yeah,
Bill's like on
so
a payphone or something, and Julian walks out, and Bill even turns around, and he's like, how'd you like the party? And Robert Downey Jr. just looks all ashamed.
No, he's kind of disgusted with himself.
Away.
Yeah. He just flees. Yeah. He's just like, books it on foot. See ya.
So, so he shows up then at Clay's house, just creeping around in the
backyard. He's like lurking around. Yeah, he's creepily lurking. And now this is right after kind of Blair and Chase.
Chase, that's fine. Whatever.
Blair and Clay are having their like look-sees back and forth with each other. Like, I'm so into you. When can we have sex in a weird place again? And then all of a sudden... Clay sees Julian.
So this is when Julian kind of comes clean to Clay. And he's like, I owe Rip $50,000. I need the money. Can you get it for me? Can you ask your dad? And Clay's like, oh, I don't know.
Well, he doesn't ask him to ask his dad. He's just like, I need it. How can you get it? And this is when this is the first time. Because like you said, all the other interactions where he's supposed to be helping his friend out. It's weird and awkward and disjointed where you're like, I don't even think he likes him as a person, as a friend. I don't think they're going to have a... But now this is when finally Clay is sort of concerned, right. And he's like, okay, I will find a way to help you, but that's just a lot of money that I can't get right away. And again, at first I was like, well, what a jerk. But I think it's because obviously he's addicted to drugs. Julian's like, well, what do you mean you can't get it? Just give me the money. I need it.
And it seems like with all these characters, anytime you ask somebody for 50 grand, their reaction isn't, holy shit, I can't get that money. Everybody's reaction's like, I don't know. Is it for a good cause? Like, okay, I think
it's
we could
like
do
that. It's
like
asking for $100. Like, you know what I mean? Like, to me, if you came to me and you're like, I need $100, I can't say why. I'd be like, that's, well, I don't know. I guess if you're not going
to
buy
drugs.
But
when Clay goes up to his dad, he's like, I need $50,000. And his dad's like, that's a lot of money. Like, that is not a reaction.
But it's available to dad. But it's available to his dad, clearly. Mm-hmm.
And I love this interaction when they're outside talking. Like, the one thing I was wondering is, I was like, oh, I wonder what's going on with Blair. And there's one point where she's knocking on the window like, hey, what are you guys doing out there? What's going on?
I'm here too, guys. I'm
Come
here
in.
Too.
I'm stuck with your boring-ass family in here.
All I want to do is have sex or do coke. Can one of you help me with one of those things?
She's got it covered. One sex, one coke.
Yeah,
easy.
One coke.
Yeah.
So when Clay goes to talk to his dad, Julian goes and interacts with Clay's younger sister, who's probably like 9 or 10. I don't know. Cute little blonde hair, blue eyed kid is playing with, I guess, her mom's jewelry. Mm-hmm.
Robert Downey Jr. kind of makes his own movie now. It's just like he's a different character. These lines don't make any sense. He's in a movie now with a little girl where he's like a babysitter or something. I don't know what's happening.
It's very weird.
It is very weird.
Yeah. A little uncomfortable.
He calls her a preteen hussy, which I thought was great.
And she just laughs at it.
She laughs at it. And then he seems hurt. He's like, oh, I can't believe you just laughed at me. Yeah. You girls are terrible. You learned this from such a young age. And I was like, what is going on in this
movie? Is the only part that I was like, is this supposed to be funny? Like, is this the comic relief part where it's like, oh, sweet, silly little Julian is.
But it's not supposed to be funny because the whole time he's pocketing jewelry. Like,
it's jewelry. Yeah. But she's trying on and
Then Clay finds this little girl, and he and Blair come to a conclusion. He's like, oh, no, he stole my mom's jewelry. What about the 50 grand? Like, we never hear whether his dad was going to give him that money
or not. Whether his dad was
going to,
yeah.
I know. Mm-hmm. I kept waiting for him to find Julian and be like, give me the jewels back. My dad's going to give me the money or something. Mm-hmm. Or my dad can't get me the money or something. That is never – it's like
– you never know what happens with him.
It's like – Julian did this on purpose. It's like he knew that he would ask his dad. Then he knew where the jewelry was. It was like it was his plan the whole time. Did you feel that way?
Yeah. Like then he figured that he, well, I think because he didn't, I think because he was fucked up and on drugs and he didn't know what was going to
listen,
work.
Listen, he's pretty smart for a dude that was that messed up on drugs.
He was the valedictorian.
He was. He was no dummy. His business failed. Anyway.
Well, that's because of his drug addiction.
So this is when Blair and Clay go to every club in L.A. or Hollywood or whatever and ask everyone. They just walk up to random people that we've never seen. And they're like, hey, have you seen Julian? And everybody's like, no, not recently. I'm like, how do all these people know Julian?
These are the clubs he frequents, though, because he's a club guy.
Yeah. But you know? I love how this whole movie is – half this movie is people looking for Julian because they go to a party and they run into Rip and Bill who are also looking for Julian.
Yep. Because he ran off earlier at the motels.
So nobody finds Julian. They drive away again in that red Corvette. They drive through a tunnel.
Mm-hmm.
And again, a part of the movie that made no sense. He slams on the brakes and he's like, oh no. We just hit a coyote. And they both get out of the car and look around and go, I don't see a coyote. Maybe it got away. maybe there was no coyote. I'm like, what are you? This is not, these are not lines that were written
down.
Now,
he's not high, but she is, right? But
she's
not.
High as a kite. He's not. They both think they hit an animal. They don't see an animal. They come to the conclusion that they never hit an animal.
They never hit the animal. No. But now they have a fight, right? Because Blair is high.
Yes.
And she's kind of freaking out about the animal and the losing Julian. And they fight because, again, this wasn't the plan, the course that Clay wanted this Christmas time to take. He thought he was coming home for Christmas to get back with Blair, maybe, you know, have the triple threat back together again. And this is so far off course that he's like, I'm going home as soon as I can, or I'm going back to the school as soon as I can. And I love you, but I can't handle this.
He's yelling at her. She's yelling at him. They get out of the car. She tries to walk away.
Mm-hmm.
Nonsense is spewed. He gets back in the car. She turns around. She gets back in the car.
Well, she's got no other choice. Where the hell is she going to go? Exactly. Ride a coyote home?
And these streets are dead throughout this movie. There is no one else on these roads. They again park their car in the middle of the road, have a fight, get out, walk away. No traffic, no issue whatsoever. So, but they do find Julian, because when they get back to Blair's apartment, he's sitting in the steps.
He's wrecked.
He is totally wrecked somehow. I guess in the meantime, he sold the jewelry, got a bunch of drugs, I guess.
That's what I think you're supposed to think, because how else does he get all, how does he get
I don't know.
Wreck?
He is a mess. And I love it because Andrew McCarthy says something like, oh, we got to get him to a hospital. And Jamie Gertz like pushes him away. And she's like, I will handle this.
Yeah,
and
she's like, I just know.
They're bickering while Robert Downey Jr.'s puking all over the place and tripping over himself and sweating and shaking.
So sweaty. Eyeliner, just blood everywhere.
But this is when, and this all happens over the course of one night, we find out. Just one evening. That's it.
Oh,
because later on, he calls and he's like, thanks a lot for last night, guys.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
This seems to take place over
longest
a week.
Longest night ever. Longest night. I thought it was over
the
course of time.
Yep, yeah. There is one point where he's in Andrew McCarthy's arms and he's got like puke all over his face and he looks up and I'm like, hey, thanks, man. Andrew McCarthy looks so grossed out by this.
He does. Yeah, he does. He's so disappointed. I mean, I guess that was a sort of relatable piece where I was like, yeah, if I came home from college and I saw my friend in this bad a shape and realized, wow, this is, I would be like, grossed out by it, you know, and to see, because she automatically falls into this, it's okay, baby, I'll take care of you.
She knows what's going on. At one point, he's like, I'm going to be sick. And she's like, you know where the bucket is?
Yeah, right, get into the bucket. Sink. Yeah, And it's a huge, sturdy metal bucket. Like, it's really like, it's the best puke bucket. But yeah, the whole them taking care of him seems really surreal for both of them, actually.
Right.
He is so sick. This seems to be something that she's pretty used to, though. I think she even mentions to him later, like, to Clay later, like, yeah, this is what it is. This is what happens. This is what life has been like since you're gone.
Yeah.
He gets
yeah.
really sick, and I take care of him. He says he's going to clean up, and then he goes back at it.
Right. And that's exactly what he does, because he wakes up, and we said he's naked and sweaty, and she's wearing her business suit. And he's even like, this is the last time. Last time, gonna be great.
Yeah, I'm not gonna do this. I'm gonna be clean.
And this is where the weird scene with his dad comes into play, with his dad playing tennis, where I think it should have been earlier in the movie, where he and his dad kind of reconcile, and he hugs his dad and everything like that. But it doesn't really go anywhere.
Mm-mm. Well, Clay, in between, before Julian goes to his dad, you do get the sense that this is Julian's, like, cleanup time, especially because Clay is here now to sort of empower him.
Okay.
Because Clay goes to the dealer. Clay goes to Rip, remember?
Yes.
When Rip is making the weird phone call in the, like, hot tub.
In his hot tub with the phone.
By himself.
With the phone that you just put in, it just floats around. I love it.
And he basically is like, stop giving drugs to Julian. Mm-hmm. Leave him alone. He needs to get clean, and you need to leave him alone.
I know, and he's cursing at Rip, and I'm thinking the whole time, yeah. I'm like, don't you see that crazy dude over there with the goatee and the shaved eyebrow? That guy's going to break your legs.
He's just watching them. He's just watching their interaction, like, what?
Which seems crazy that he's just in this hot tub with his bodyguard hanging out with him. It seems
strange. It is weird. It's a weird, mm-hmm. and it's like in this huge, like, because there's a huge pool, but he's in the hot tub section of the pool by himself.
This is where Rip starts to, like, he says things that sound reasonable. Like, he's like, why do you care about Julian? What does it matter?
Yeah.
What has he ever done for you? He's dead. Mm-hmm. Forget about him. He's dragging you down with him. You have a good thing going. Don't worry about this guy, which sounds reasonable. But again, if we take into consideration their history and that they are friends, it makes sense that he would be there sticking up for his friend and saying, I'll get you the money. Yeah. I'll sell my car. Which he never does.
Yeah, he does.
Like, I was waiting for him to do that.
Yeah, but he doesn't. He doesn't. But he does try to, like,
their
get
car,
them.
My favorite character in the movie, you're going to sell it. And I guess then Rip and Bill trash Blair's apartment, which seems terrible. Like,
well, that's, but I think that's because that's the only place that Julian called home.
Okay.
Was mm-hmm. her place.
Right.
So they do. Julie, now, this is when I thought we were coming to a...
But thank God there's messages on the answering machine. Good thing they didn't delete those. Because she listens to answering machine messages where it's some random girl that we've seen at the beginning, which I thought was funny. Right. It was just some girl at the party. And she's like, we're going out to the desert. It's going to be awesome. We're going to this party.
Oh, yeah. The springs.
Right. For no reason. I don't know why this message was important. And then there's, right after that, there's a message from Julian saying, I'm going out to the springs.
Mm-hmm,
Wait,
mm-hmm.
Is this just to tell us that there's a party going on? Because there is.
It's just to let us know where they're headed, where they're headed to the next party.
But anyway, let's get to the climactic end of this movie.
Well, I'm happy to see the red blotch shirt back again. When he goes to Palm Springs, he brings that red shirt
mm-hmm.
back.
Mm-hmm. And he's in like a shitty hotel room. Like, it looks like a hotel room. We find out later that Rip has, like, a suite at a hotel, and I guess that's what this is.
And I guess that coke was big for the gays in Palm Springs.
There's a lot of guys.
Right?
And they all look like just terrible extras from, like, soaps. It just looks like they're like, all right, let's find a bunch of dudes in their mid-20s. They're going to be extras. Let's dress them up in crazy outfits and have them just stand around and stare at each other. I don't think anybody's talking at all.
Mm-mm. No, it's a really weird...
It looks uncomfortable and odd.
Mm-hmm. I guess they're just waiting for Julian to show up and start, like,
I guess,
romancing them. I don't know.
And because Rip easily convinces him to start blowing dudes. Like,
well, not that easily. Let's not forget this. So Julian doesn't go to Palm Springs to party.
No.
Julian goes to Palm Springs. This I thought was weird, too. But again, I guess because he's under the influence of drugs. He goes to Palm Springs to tell his drug dealer, listen, I don't do drugs anymore. I'm not gonna buy your drugs anymore.
Right.
I'm gonna figure out a way to give you the money I owe you, but I'm getting clean now.
Mm-hmm.
Who goes? Who does that?
You would assume he could maybe call him or something.
Right. His fancy little hot tub phone or something.
Right, exactly.
And
you don't show up at his hotel where he's surrounded
where he's
by gay dudes and
mm-hmm.
drugs everywhere to tell him, listen, I'm done being your gay prostitute. I'm done doing drugs.
See all this around you? I'm not going to be a part of it. And then he's like, oh, yeah, crack in your mouth. Go blow this guy.
Here's a pipe. Bill even light it up for you. You don't even need to do that. And there's like 12 dudes out there, so you can work off a lot of this debt in one night.
Right, you could work out at least $600 of that debt just tonight, so go to it.
But in the meantime, Clay and Blair find out where he is. They go to a party, to the party
with all the TVs.
The girl called and said they were at a party.
Mm-hmm.
So they go there, find out that he is at this hotel. Mm-hmm. Andrew McCarthy walks in on him blowing a guy, which is a great scene because This extra, again, I swear, these people are not actors, right? Because this extra, like, Robert Downey Jr. is like, oh, and he, like, backs away, and Andrew McCarthy grabs him, and this extra on the bed pulls up his pants, and he's like, hey, what's going on here? I thought everything was cool. So he rescues him, gets him out of this crazy scene. Mm-hmm. But then they have to go back to the party to get Jamie Gertz.
Because they left her behind.
They left her behind for some reason, but she is empowering herself at this time.
Well, I love it. Because she's at the party with, I think there's a group of girls that I think we saw. These were the girls sitting on the TVs. TVs in their crotches. Yeah, it's the same group mm-hmm. of kind of whatever, druggy girls that... are their friends, and they're all doing, I like they make a comment like, oh my God, this year's party was so much better than last year's. And Jamie Gertz is like, actually, it was exactly the same.
Mm-hmm. She's waking up to the situation and the hell that she's been living in.
Right? And she's over it. She goes, they all are in the bathroom doing their coke, and she dumps hers out right there in the sink. And they're like, I like how they're like, what a waste. What are you doing? She's like, call a plumber.
Nope. Yep. And makes no sense. No sense at all. You can't think of a better line to write. Call the plumber. That doesn't mean anything.
Plumber, my coke is down the drain. I don't know. Call a plumber, she says.
All right. But anyway, so they get her. Clay and Julian mm-hmm. have kind of a blowout in the car. They have kind of a fight. And this is when... Julian, like, leaves the car, and he's like, oh, blah, blah. And then Clay chases him and yells mm-hmm. at him and gets him back in the car. And James Spader, Bill, mm-hmm. Jamie Gertz, and Andrew McCarthy all have a big
fight. They all have a fist fight.
There's a big fist fight at this party, which, as they're yelling at each other, as this fight builds up, in this entire movie, I can't take my eyes off the extras. Everybody is completely oblivious to the fact that these people are screaming at each other.
It's their weird reaction. Again, mm-hmm. I guess because we're supposed to think they're all on drugs, but it's a weird reaction to the fact that there's a three-way fist fight mm-hmm. happening.
Yeah, and people are mm-hmm. hitting each other with things.
Yeah, they have a pole from – he grabs something off the, like, one art piece thing and hits.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. Yeah. But eventually they do get away.
Mm-hmm.
For some reason now, because the movie needs this to happen, Julian is dying?
I think he, at some point, he must, like, this is what I think. So.
Oh, okay.
They leave with him, right? They finally get him in the car.
Yep.
He's in bad shape, but it's because he was off of drugs for, I guess, like you said, it was just a day. I thought it was like a week, like a couple of days. But he was off of drugs, and now obviously when he was at this party where he told his drug dealer, I'm not doing drugs anymore, he did do drugs. And then I think that while he was there, he must have gotten even more drugs that he had on him. Because they go, they leave, they have to drive off
You
really
are
fast.
Really filling in the blanks of this movie. I understand that you have to do that so that the ending makes sense.
Exactly. I'm trying to. So they escape. They drive out of the party to leave.
Right.
Like spin with the red convertible Corvette, whatever.
Right.
And they drive off. They stop somewhere for gas. And, right?
Yep. Yep.
And when Julian goes to use the bathroom, he comes back out and he can't walk right. He's like, oh, forgot to use my legs or some kind of goofy like. I forgot to be walking.
Yep.
But I think that we're meant to think that whatever drugs he had left in mm-hmm. his pocket or wherever, he did. Like, because all of a sudden he's really fucked up.
Right.
And you're like, wait a minute.
Right. I was wondering why this escalated or how this even happened. But okay, that makes sense. I would have liked to have seen that scene.
Yeah, I agree. Or seen even the scene where maybe he, like, got a lot, like, that's how I interpreted it. Somehow he must have gotten even more drugs and he put them in his system once they got him.
No, that makes sense.
Then he's really wrecked while they're driving.
Definitely wrecked.
And for some reason they decide to drive. You saw, you've been there. Yep. They drive through the Joshua Tree.
Sure, why not? Why not?
That's a place to be.
Take him to a hospital. Don't do anything to help him. Just drive him around.
Just drive. Just go for a long drive.
And also maybe park on the side of the road and take a break. Last time he did this, he threw up all over the place. Do you want him puking in that car? No.
No, you don't.
Come on.
It's an uncomfortable ride for the three of them. It's a long ride. Mm-hmm. And they're all very tired.
Oh, so sleepy.
Can't keep our eyes open.
You may say that Robert Downey Jr. is dead tired.
Well, this is... Clay is driving, and he's, like, you could tell. Now, let me tell you that Palm Springs and Joshua Tree are not that far away from each other, but they seem like they've been driving all night, right? Because yes. They're so tired, and he's so sleepy from driving. And Julian rests his head on Clay's shoulder, and mm-hmm. Clay's like, Julian, stop! What?
You
I'm
crazy,
just trying
Julian.
To drive.
He even smiles like, oh, you nut. You crazy nut.
Right.
He's totally dead. Like
he's dead.
Totally dead.
He's dead. He's dead.
And
so he stops the car, and sleepy Jamie Gertz, they have to wake her up. What's going on? What happened? I don't know. Dead.
Dead.
No heartbeat.
Dead.
And you should have gone to the hospital, you fools.
And I don't want to say that Andrew McCarthy is a bad actor, because he got jobs for some reason. Maybe it's his boyish good looks, but...
He was pretty cute in there, yeah.
His reaction to... Robert Downey Jr. being dead is much like his reaction of Weekend at Bernie's. Like, it's kind of like, ick, this, oh, I can't, oh, yeah, I this, can't believe it. Like, Jamie Gertz is breaking down, she's crying, and he's just kind of
like,
sitting there like,
him, yeah.
Oh, I can't believe this is happening. Like, it's so, he seems put out by this whole situation.
Well, he seems like, fuck, we were so close to getting him out and done with this, and now you die? Like, you couldn't have died before. He's kind of like annoyed, like, I did all this. I watched you puke. I took care of you through the night while you were trying to get sober. I asked my dad for... He's like annoyed that we got this far and now you die.
It's crazy. His reaction's nuts.
Yeah,
so
I agree.
We dissolve to a cemetery.
Yeah, yeah.
He's That's been happened. Buried... They tell some stories about him, like, oh, remember the time that, not funny, not entertaining, because
no,
I don't know.
I'm going to miss him so much. I like when she's like, I'm just
right,
going to miss
the relationship
him so
between
much.
These characters does not seem real to me at all.
No, and then it's weird, because that's like I said, so Clay brings up how he's known him since he's five. Mm-hmm. He goes into this whole thing, like, oh, yeah. I remember when he was five, and that's when we get to hear... How
his
mom
died
when
mm-hmm.
he was young, and he carried around a telegram or something
sure.
like that.
Why not?
Dad gave
yep.
him.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I guess Jamie Gertz wasn't friends with them from that age. I don't know when she met them, but she was like, this story was new to her. And I think this was the attempt to make you feel like, oh, that's why he got into drugs. He has mommy issues. Oh, that's why he... Because he's like, oh, he was so strong as a kid. When his mom died, he stayed so strong. And
I like to think that Clay was the only person holding him together. When he went to college, everything must have fallen
apart. Uh-huh.
But he asked Jamie Gertz to go back to college with him.
And she's like, absolutely.
That sounds like a great idea now.
Yeah.
The end of the movie. Like,
mm-hmm.
that is it.
Film mm-hmm. moving on. Yeah.
That's how this movie
uh-huh.
ends after all mm-hmm. that craziness. Oh, boy, Jamie, we talked about this movie for a long time. There's so much to sort through with this movie.
Oh, wait, you know what we haven't discussed yet? Have you ever seen this movie?
I did. I did because a lot
of... Oh,
you
did?
Yeah, a lot of this movie looked familiar to me, and I knew mm-hmm. what was going to happen and everything. I don't remember mm-hmm. when I saw it. It wasn't a memorable viewing experience for me, but mm-hmm. I know I had seen it before.
Hmm.
You?
I had never. Okay. No, I didn't even know it existed, to be honest.
All right. Would you recommend that people see this movie?
No.
Okay. Yeah, I feel the same way.
Yeah. I was sort of, for our, I think maybe if I watched it at the time, or maybe mm-hmm. even in college myself, right. when I was more, not that I did coke in college, but I just did, you know, more whatever, maybe then I would have related better to it.
It seemed like you said, and like you just said now, it just seemed so unrelatable. These characters seem so
mm-hmm.
unrelatable and shallow, and mm-hmm. and I get it. Like that's
I had
the
no
point.
Need to
like,
care for any of them,
right.
though. And even their relationships, I didn't. their friendships didn't seem sincere.
And if you read any Easton Ellis stuff, like if you read Rules of Attraction and if you read American Psycho, and I'm sure it's the same way in Less Than Zero, the characters are unlikable and they are shallow, but these characters didn't even seem real. Like, they didn't seem like real human beings. And I want to know, is Jamie Gertz like starting school there, or is she just going to move out there?
I think she's just following him because now they're in love. And but, and that, again, even like their relationship.
But they're not like, in love. It just, it doesn't.
That was what was weird is like, if they had at least shown like in high school, they were high school sweethearts. I really just thought they were three good friends in high school.
That's what it looked
and
like. Yeah.
Then, it, like you said, was their love kind of infused with drugs? Was it infused by, because he does say like he loves her and then he missed her while he was gone. But
I feel like down the road it's just going to be like she's going to resent him because he took her away from her modeling career.
I see where this is going.
He's going to feel really bad because he'll realize that he's probably responsible for his friend's death. Like maybe he shouldn't have just ditched the dude. Like I don't know. It just, I don't know. Nothing about this seemed relatable, and the characters just seemed like these weird cartoon characters.
Yeah, that weren't complete in some sense. Yeah, I agree. So what do you recommend then?
I'm going to recommend a movie that I've never heard anyone talk about in my life.
Wow.
So I hope I'm turning
obscure
people...
Obscure much?
I hope I'm turning people onto a movie that they've never seen.
Okay.
It's a movie that I found on Netflix years ago. From 2002, it's called The Champagne Club. It's a movie by a visual artist. I'm not even going to try and pronounce his name, but I think his last name is Machado. It's about, it reminded me of this movie because it's like if Julian and three other Julians had a ton of drugs and went to a mansion in the middle of nowhere. So it's these people, they go to a mansion in the middle of nowhere and just do drugs, and they all slowly become insane. Parts of it are played for laughs and it works.
Okay.
But it looks like this movie. Like they're all dressed like they should
be
in
the 80s? When does it take place?
It takes place in the 80s.
Okay.
At one point, they have lines of coke down a hallway. So if somebody did like a line of coke that was 30 feet long.
Wow, that's a lot of coke.
They should probably die, but these people do it and they are having a blast. Like it's, and people, if anybody finds this movie and watches it, like I could see how people could watch it. The performances are bad and it, it
no
seems,
names are in it.
No. And it feels like a self-indulgent piece of tripe at times, but because an artist made it, like the visuals are amazing. Like it is, it's a movie that looks incredible.
Okay.
So that's it. The Champagne Club. I've never heard anybody talk about it. I thought I watched it once and I dreamed it. Like I,
you were like, wait a
like
minute.
Years later, when I decided to recommend this movie, it took me so long to find it. Cause I was like, I think champagne's in the
name.
It might not be real. And I'm like, champagne room. And it kept taking me to all these strip clubs. I'm like, this isn't
No.
So I would recommend people take a look. So, yeah. What about you?
Well, I had, after the movie, I was trying to think of recommendations and all the drug movies kind of came in my head that I would know of, like Drugstore Cowboy,
right.
Fear and Loathing was one that came up because that's a drug movie that I actually kind of enjoyed because it's sort of a fun drug movie. Fear and Loathing in Vegas with Johnny Depp. And then the other movie that I would recommend because it, to me it's a fun kind of journey of someone fucked up. Barfly with Mickey Rourke.
Oh, that's so much fun.
Yes. So that, again, it's like a little more of a like, about the, you know, Bukowski and stuff.
And
Ricky Mork. Ricky Mork is like a, you know, there, he's kind of on the same line as like
he's
a Robert
so
Downey
great,
Jr.
though, too. And I don't want to say that Robert Downey Jr. isn't. I'm hoping that at some point there will be like, you know how we're in the midst of the McConaissance right now? Where Matthew McConaughey made all those shitty romantic comedies for years and years.
Yeah.
And now he's taking
and now
really
he's
great.
Like,
I want that
I
to happen.
I sell Cadillacs. I'm very serious.
I want that to happen to Robert Downey Jr. I mean, Iron Man is fine. Sherlock Holmes is fine. But he is a talented guy. Like,
very.
He should be doing better work than he's doing.
I agree. I agree.
So I hope that's right around the corner.
I hope that's coming. I do.
All right. So 2 weeks from now, folks, if you are not familiar with our podcast, you should know that December is our theme month. Mm-hmm. Last year we did holiday themed TV movies. So if you have not listened to our Smoky Mountain Christmas episode,
oh, you need to go. You should visit that.
And yeah. While I would love to watch that again and talk about it,
it's your favorite new holiday movie.
We are going to celebrate a brand new holiday, Jamie. Mm-hmm. It is called Hanukkori. It's kind of like Hanukkah. But I guess you decorate your house with like empty whiskey bottles and crack pipes or something,
I guess. Yeah.
So we are going to cover, we get three movies in December. We're going to cover the three movies from the 80s that Corey Haim and Corey Feldman were in together.
Yo.
And you may be thinking, weren't they in a ton of movies together? Yes, but most of them were in the 90s. There were only three movies in the 80s that they were in together. And the first one we're going to cover is the 1987's The Lost Boys. So it's a movie that people always want us to do at Halloween. A lot of people recommended it again this year, but I took it out of the running because I knew we were going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So we get to watch them fight vampires. We get to see Jamie Gertz again, if you're excited about that. Jason Patrick. The grandfather from the Gilmore Girls is in it.
Okay. We got a good cast here.
But anyway, that'll be in 2 weeks, and it will start our three-part Corey extravaganza.
I'm so excited.
So, everybody, we will see you guys in 2 weeks.
Yes.
Where we talk about sexy vampires.
Woo! Right?
Kiefer Sutherland and Bill from Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Oh, yeah, that's right. And again, the great Jamie Gertz.
Great Jamie Gertz, who I'm starting to think wasn't all that great. No offense, Jamie Gertz, but I'm starting to wonder what the big deal was. That's it. Man. We will see everybody in 2 weeks.
Two more.
All right, bye.
All right. Ciao. Good night. Don't forget to check out our podcast on all the variable ways there are to check out our podcast.
You know, Facebook, Twitter, etc.
Etsy? Are we on Etsy? Do we make crafts as well? I don't know.
I'd stitch like a RoboCop pillow or something. Yes, but please check us out there and subscribe to the podcast. Leave us a review. We love reviews.
We do.
We don't get enough. All right. That's it. See you guys.
Bye. Time, see what's become of me. While I looked around for my possibilities, I was so hard to please. Look around.
What's going on? I'm serious.
No, would it be a hemphedipedal?
Yep, a hemphedipedal. Exactly.